Hello and welcome. You are watching Lockdown TV. This is the pop-up news and discussion program from unheard.com. It is today day 31 of the lockdown here in the UK. That is a full month. We have been legally mandated to stay at home, except certain particular reasons for leaving the house. And during all that time at home, we have been doing some big thinking. We have brought in some fascinating views from across the world to try and get a better perspective of what this all means and what kind of world we might inherit after it. And today is no different. I am delighted that we are joined from Los Angeles by Rohan Silva. Hi, Ro.
Hey, buddy.
And from Connecticut by David Neeleman. Hi, David. So Rohan will be known to some of our, certainly UK viewers, as someone who was in Number 10 Downing Street with Cameron and Osborne, and subsequently founded a company called Second Home that has bases in Portugal, London, and America, which is why he's there at the moment. And David is the founder of JetBlue, the domestic airline in the US, as well as a number of other airlines, including Azul in Brazil. So let's just start going to LA then, Rohan. What is the situation in LA? Are you legally locked down, and what is life like?
Yeah, so big lockdown here. There's a list of companies, businesses that are allowed to stay open. Gun shops, I think cannabis dispensaries, all the essentials. Offices are required to close, and but I think it is slightly different. There's quite a strong civil liberties tradition in America, so there's not that sense of people getting pulled over as they're driving around to check where they're going. There's not drones flying overhead, as I think there have been over parts of London. So it is a lockdown. It's a very formal lockdown, but I think it feels reasonably mellow. LA is such a sprawling metropolis, quite hard, I think, at the best of times to police and manage. I think the mood, though, I think seems to be shifting. We've been under lockdown for a similar length of time. California, Northern California went first. LA followed soon afterwards. Here, the mayor has set a date for the end of lockdown. Mayor Garcetti, mayor of LA, has said the 15th of May will be the end of the lockdown period. Now, clearly, he could extend that. But, you know, I think the sense of the economic pain here is really to the fore. In LA County, the sort of city of LA, unemployment has now reached 50%. There are no, yeah.
So, I was just going to ask on that, your own company, Second Home, which does offices for startups and technology companies, you've got bases in continental Europe, London, and LA. Mm-hmm. What has the impact been on those different ones, and how have they differed from each other?
Well, it's been a massive crunch, because your revenues suddenly begin to fall off a cliff. And we're luckier than hotels or cafes and retailers in that if you've got a team based at Second Home, one of our locations, you have a long-term contract with us. So we have sort of recurring revenue. So we're luckier than lots of companies, and I know that. But your revenues start to fall away because our health, Second Home, is dependent. We're a small business, but we're dependent on the health of hundreds of other small businesses. And right now we've seen maybe one in five of the small businesses at Second Home already go under.
So go under means finished, gone bust?
Yeah, finished, you know, gone out of business. And then the remaining four-fifths at different levels of stress. And the challenge, and what's been really surprising and terrifying, to be honest, Freddie, is that we're seeing that crunch for small businesses across every sector. So it's not just the teams at Second Home that also maybe have a physical shop that you could imagine, or a travel business, but also cosmetics companies and professional services companies getting crunched in different ways. When the economy stops as it has, people stop paying suppliers. And so that cascades through, particularly the small business economy, so quickly. And the typical small business only has a few weeks of cash on in hand, so it can happen very quickly.
What are you doing with your employees and workers over there?
Yeah, so in London and in Lisbon, where we have locations, there are you know, good government wage support schemes. And I think Portugal borrowed from Rishi Sunak in the UK. And so we've been able to move most of our team onto those wage support schemes. We've kept a small team on because there are things we're still doing during this shutdown. In LA, really heartbreakingly, there are no support schemes like that at all. And so we've had to let a bunch of people go, which is a horrible thing to do. We've got a great team. Obviously, we want to hire everyone back.
What sort of percentage of your workers have you laid off?
In LA, it's 8 out of 10. And so we much smaller company than David's, but we employ about 150 people worldwide, about 30 in LA. And yeah, 8 out of 10, 9 out of 10 in LA, we've had to let go. And of course, in addition, there are lots of hourly contractors, cleaners, gardeners, security guards, and so on. And they've seen their incomes fall almost to nothing as well.
David, let's come to you. Thanks for joining us. You're in the airlines business, really. You founded, is it 5 airlines?
Yeah.
So what has the impact been? I mean, one would imagine they're kind of first to go. What's happened to the companies you're involved in?
Well, I think, talking about the airline business in general, it's obviously devastating because it's a high fixed cost business. So you have a lot of fixed costs. The biggest costs are obviously fuel, which we're not using now, but you have labor costs and you have, obviously the aircraft costs, which are very expensive. So if you have a high cost, fixed cost business, and then the revenue goes to nothing, then the cash burn is just absolutely enormous. And so, starting kind of in Brazil, we've got great people. We have 13,000 people that work for us in Brazil. 10,000 of them agreed to go off without pay because they just wanted to save the company. They just had a great job. And this is a company, we had 20% operating margins last year. We had more than one of the most profitable airlines in the world. And then all of a sudden, from most profitable airline in the world to kind of, revenues completely stopping. And, even though we had, a boatload of cash, when you're, burning, significant amount of money per day, then obviously that money starts to dwindle pretty quickly. So, there was a report.
Is that right? So 10 out of 13,000 of your staff are on unpaid leave.
Well, they're unpaid, and then the government came in with some support. So they're actually going to be getting some money as well. And then also the government's going to be helping us, with loans and doing some other things. So we're going to be fine. The biggest question is how quickly this returns. Are we going to be 50% of where we were by the fourth quarter? Are we going to be 75%? Are we going to be 25%? Because I think if this thing really goes on for a long time, I think there's this thing, oh, we're going to wait for a vaccine and then we're going to be fine. The vaccine could never come. I think that's becoming quite obvious that if this thing, mutates a little bit, that, it's like the flu. You can't get a sure vaccine for the flu. So, I think the question is, can we learn to live with it until we get some kind of, population immunity?
So in terms of government support, here we've got spokesmen from, I suppose, two of the more controversial industries, really. I mean, Rohan's business survives off technology startups, basically, and yours, the airline business is controversial when we talk about it in terms of bailouts, both because of the environmental groups feel that it shouldn't be supported, but also because it tends to have wealthy proprietors. And if, there's been a lot of talk that if Trump is going to bail out the airlines, it's going to be another kind of check to his millionaire buddies, and that actually they should be taking a risk. What do you say to that kind of thinking?
Well, it's a little bit ludicrous because, airlines, airlines drive enormous amounts of economic activity into, a country or a state. For example, I'm a big shareholder of TAP, Portugal Airlines, in Lisbon. And, Lisbon is a very isolated country. It's far away from Europe. We're 2 hours flight from even Paris, where, you know, longer than that from Frankfurt, and London's a couple of hours. About, you know, almost 20% of Portugal's total GDP is related to tourism. And it employs, you know, millions and millions of people. And if you take the TAP contribution to the local economy from being able to bring people who never would have come to Portugal. I mean, when we privatized TAP, we were flying one city in the United States, and now we're flying eight in the United States. And so Portugal's become this really hot, exciting destination where people really want to be. And I'm sure Rohan has benefited from that. So, but if you take our direct impact to the economy, just the people that we employ that actually pay income taxes at the rate that there is in Portugal, it's six or 800 million a year, just that money from the people that are employed. And then you take, you know, all the restaurants and hotels, and it's a multi-billion dollar a year impact. So if you go to, you know, the government and say, look, you make, you know, call it 2 billion a year direct from this company. If the company doesn't exist and it's gone, you're going to lose that money. But we need support of, you know, $500 million, which is like a payback of 3 months, you know, in normal times. Then it makes a lot of sense. It's just an investment in making sure that you keep the engine that drives your economy.
And do you think you will get that kind of support in the?
Yeah, I mean, I think the government in Portugal, we're very close. I mean, they're actually a shareholder. They own 50%, you know, the voting share. They're on our board. And, you know, they understand the value of TAP, you know, to Portugal. So, yeah, absolutely. I mean, it would be crazy not to, right? I mean, obviously, if they didn't have an airline that would bring people to Portugal, you know, by the tens of thousands, then there would be literally, a couple million people that would become unemployed in Portugal, of a country of 10 million people. So, you know, they don't have industry, you know, like other countries. They really depend on tourism. And so, you know, this thing of don't help the airlines, you're just helping rich people. It's not. It's helping the taxi drivers, you know, the people who work in restaurants, the people who work in hotels, the people who, you know, it helps everybody because it drives so much economic benefit.
Rohan, let me just come back to you then on this point, because it's so crucial, isn't it? After the last set of bailouts, which were a lot of people feel let the banks off the hook.
Yeah.
You know, and then you've got you've been a policy guy. You've worked in a political context. How should the government rescues be structured to make sure that the help goes first and foremost to the people who most need it?
Yeah. Well, look, I think the first thing to say is that small businesses have done nothing wrong right now. You know, the government has adopted, you know, perfectly understandably, a shutdown strategy that's shut down economic activity in large parts of the economy, and leading to what the economist Ken Rogoff has described as a slaughter of small businesses. And so small businesses have done nothing wrong. And I think there is this sort of view, which is, well, you know, if you're a good company, you can survive this. Well, small businesses, large companies, in a normal recession, things slow down relatively slowly, and companies, if they're well run, can make adjustments and efficiency savings and so on. This is just a sudden cliff edge of economic activity and revenues falling to zero. So no small business can survive this. And, you know, the large companies can access lines of credit, have other means of tapping into money and government debt programs and things. So government really does have to step in here. And I think that has to be the starting point, is government acknowledging that small businesses have done nothing wrong. And I think a lot of the schemes we've seen, particularly the government loan scheme, are based on this idea that, you know, small businesses have got to repay government and repay the banks at often very high levels of interest. Mm-hmm. And what's daft about that? A, I think it's ethically wrong, because small businesses, as I say, haven't done anything wrong. So why should they be burdened with high levels of debt going forward? But I think it's also strategically the wrong approach, because it means that small businesses, who often are surviving on a kind of wafer edge anyway, and very, very thin margins anyway, to add debt payments onto that, at best will mean you slow down their growth in the future, because any money they make has to go into paying these loans back. But more likely, we'll just kill these companies down the line. So, you know, the Treasury's instincts, I used to be a Treasury civil servant, Treasury's instincts are always to you know, save money, be prudent. And that's the right approach. It's just not the right instinct in this moment.
I wouldn't say the British Treasury's instinct is necessarily to save money at the moment, but...
I think the loan scheme, say, you know, compare it to the US, where there are loans to small businesses under the US bailout, but those are fully forgiven, written off, if that money is spent on rent or hiring extra people and things. The UK loans to small businesses are nothing of the sort, aren't ever forgiven. You know, yeah. They'll be repaid, and as I say, they're expensive loans. So you know, you've got the other approaches available. They could have said that instead we will stand behind insurance companies. Most companies have insurance policies, but I think about half of small businesses have business interruption insurance. Mine does, which means that, you know, if you have a fire, you don't just get money back for the contents lost, but also any lost revenue while you were shut down because of the fire. The insurance companies have made clear that coronavirus, they're not going to pay out under business interruption policy. I can understand why, because if they're having to pay out to 10 million companies or you know, 5 million companies simultaneously, they might fall over. But if government were to stand behind the insurance companies, enabling them to pay that money out, you know, that would immediately be a solution. But it's expensive.
So let's, you know, having gotten our picture of just how grave the economic threat is, what is it that you guys want to happen now? Because it seems like you sort of believe that whether the lockdowns were the right decision or not, you're on the side of easing them. What is the politics of this? I mean, it's up to the state governors. Donald Trump seems to be kind of dithering in one direction, the other slightly on the wisdom of these lockdowns. What do you want to see happen? And what's the political route in the real world to that happening? David.
Well, I think, it has become, you know, quite political here in the U.S. You know, if you like Donald Trump or not, you know, he's still our president, and, you know, at least until November. And so, you know, he's trying to, you know, do the best he can. And obviously, being a businessman himself, he would like to see the country open up and would like to see people go back to work. But obviously, on the other side, you know, there are these people. There are a group of people that basically, you know, are against opening up the economy, and they're against it because they feel like, you know, we have to wait for a vaccine or we have to wait for more therapies to come about, and it's just way too risky, you know. And it's a little bit crazy. I've been, you know, working with some doctors at Stanford that are actually doing some serological surveying, and you know, they actually did a test in LA where Rohan is. They found almost 5% of the people were already infected, which is, you know, 70 times different than the official rate. And then they did the same test in Santa Clara, California, where they found it was 80 times more people could be infected. And it's amazing how many people are just coming out and attacking, you know, that report and trying to poke holes in it. The good news is, and I think there's a lot.
Just to explain, and so this is the Stanford report. Which tested people in Santa Clara County, has been criticized by Andrew Gelman at Stanford and a number of other academics for various reasons that it's to do with margins of error and whether or not those results were reliable. You think those attacks are political rather than academic?
I don't think so. I think it's kind of really, it's all kind of rolled into one, right? So I think. There's no doubt there's people that want, President Trump to fail. I mean, just the way it is. They have a, you know, visceral reaction to him. And I think things get conflated together. And, you know, there's no doubt that, you know, the people that are kind of poking holes or trying to poke holes, and, you know, they poke holes and then the media carries the message. So it's kind of, I'm not saying that there's anything sinister here, you know, particularly on the side of the academics, you know, because, you know, there were questions. The two major questions have been raised about the tests that, you know, that were done in Santa Clara County and Los Angeles is, number one, the validity of the test itself and, you know, actually picking up the people. And, you know, it has to do with the fact of false positives. You know, were there false positives that were that were found, which they call specificity, what the specificity score is. So that's the number one issue. That's one issue. And then the other issue is, you know, how did they do their sample size? You know, did they, you know, in Santa Clara County, they did it on Facebook. And so was there selection bias where a guy kind of felt like he had been sick, so he came in and got tested. So, but all that's gonna change here pretty quickly, because New York is actually doing one right now, a 3,000 person study. I think they're doing it with an ELISA test, which is a venous blood draw test, which is much more, you know, reliable. I have been heavily involved in the testing of these tests, you know, even on the UK side and on the US side, and talking to Berkeley Lab is going to publish a report, the same that the British government did, you know, a few weeks ago. And, you know, I'm convinced that the specificity number is not a problem. That's not the issue. And that goes to the heart of the reliability of these tests. We're actually going to, you know, I'm working on doing a test here in Connecticut. You know, I live in a county right outside the door here that has 1% of our people have tested positive. We've had 600 deaths, and this is a county of a million people. And so we're going to survey, you know, 3,000 people. And if we find the prevalence of this virus is 25 or 30% here, that's really going to change things. We're not going to be arguing about 4 or 5% in Santa Clara and LA. And obviously, the higher percentage you get, the whole specificity issue goes away.
David, so just so I understand, because this is the key to the whole question of what the strategy can be going forward. Yes. Whether, you know, in the case of the Santa Clara and Los Angeles studies, whether they show 3% or 4% or 5% or 2%, it doesn't really make that much difference, because yes, it would show that the fatality rate is lower and that not many more people have got the infection, but it's still a small number, right? So it's not like those places are approaching immunity, or that you could just release the lockdowns and in confidence that nothing bad would happen. I actually thought they were quite small numbers that came out of those.
Well, tests. Yeah.
So what do they do now if it's only 4%?
Well, that's a very good question. And I think, you know, it's certainly one that needs to be asked. So, you know, if it's 5%, let's just use 5%. Let's just be, you know, optimistic and say it's 5%. That's 95% of people that haven't been infected. So that's what makes people obviously concerned. Well, the first thing you do, you know, with the 5%, let's just take my Connecticut example here. So I have 1%, we have 1% of the population that's test positive. And, you know, I have, you know, say that we come with 20% that actually are positive in Connecticut. That's 20 times difference. And so what you do is you take this mortality rate of, you know, 5% that we have today, and you divide it by 20, which gets you down to 0.25%. Now, you can say, well, 300 million people get infected, and you can still lose 600,000 people. So that's, you know, obviously better, but it still doesn't solve the problem. Well, what you can do, these models, the reason these models are so far off, you know, when Neil Ferguson lowered his from 500,000 down to 20,000, and now it's, you know, maybe a little higher, is they're using the wrong case infection to mortality rate. So the first thing you got to do is put in the right, because what we're trying to do is solve for hospital capacity and ICU capacity. So it's very helpful if you can use the right number as opposed to one that's not being used. So you can better take care of the ICU beds. Now, this is the second thing that I think is actually probably even more important, is that, you know, that's the numerator. Well, now how about the denominator? You know, I mean, that's the denominator. Now, how about the numerator? You know, what we know in New York is that 25% of all the deaths were in nursing homes. So, you know, if we could have just locked down those nursing homes and did a different strategy of dealing with the nursing homes, you know, because what they did is they followed the WHO recommendations and said, wash your hands, don't touch your face, you're going to be okay. Well, they actually went in and breathed on these people, and they all got infected, and, you know, and sadly, so many people died. So, you know, I think my exit plan would be, let's know the denominator. Let's do the calculation on really the true calculation on how many ICU beds and hospitals we need. But then also, if you know, for example, if we learn in New York that 2 million people are already infected, you know, yesterday Cuomo said he wants to hire an army of contact tracers. Well, contact trace 2 million people and 90% of them never knew they even had it. That seems to be, you know, an overwhelming thing. I would take that army of contact tracers, and I would turn them into caseworkers, and I would first of all, I'd contract trace everyone who died. That's easier than 2 million people. I would determine, you know, how did they get infected? What were their morbidities? and how old were they? And then I would identify that population, and I would take those thousands of people and I would go care for those people and make sure they didn't get infected. And I think if you did that, you could flatten the curve without flattening the economy.
Rohan, let me come back to you here on the politics, really. I mean, this is something you know a lot about. You know, you're sort of, you come from, I guess, a sort of Remainer left liberal version of the Tories in some way originally, and then now I'm not sure where you are. But what's the landscape there? I mean, is it the case in Los Angeles that basically Democrats are pro lockdown and the few number of Republicans that admit to being so are anti, or what's the deal?
Yeah. Not many Trump bumper stickers where I am in LA, but the certainly it does feel much more politicized than the debate in the UK. And so if you're on the side of opening up, you're basically treated as a Trump supporter. And you know, I think what David's sort of getting at, which I think is really important, and you know, you've been doing such a great job on Unheard as well, is, you know, I think policymakers have been led by the data throughout, and you know, to their credit, around the world, and whether it was initially the World Health Organization number of, you know, 3.4% fatality rate, whether it was then the Imperial College study, policymakers have been led by the data. And I think I'm more hopeful, in truth, that the UK will pivot or evolve its policy based on data than I am about America. I think America's become, it's so ideological and so divided. And unfortunately, the response to the shutdown, you know, reflects that, which is a real shame, because this should be about the data and the science and best understandings. And what is an incredibly complex trade-off between, you know, the damage caused by the shutdown, economically, health, and so on, as well as the risks posed by opening up. And there are risks and damages on both sides. I think.
Do you mean that? Do you think people are digging in? Is that so? Governor Newsom, for example, of California, has talked about life not being back to normal till the end of the year. Schools might not open till September. Do you think that kind of talk is politically driven, or is that where you're?
I do think there's, you know, unfortunately, you know, politics is playing a big part of it over here in America. And so if you look at California, Gavin Newsom, the governor of California, has partnered up with the governors of Oregon and Washington State to kind of coordinate their opening up efforts. Why are they doing that? I think principally because if you open up too early, you may get blamed for a spike in cases. And of course, you know, during the shutdown, hopefully hospital capacity, ventilator capacity is increasing, but otherwise nothing else has really changed. When we open up, it's not like there's suddenly going to be a vaccine. So we're faced with the same situation we did before. So I think in all kinds of ways, the politics of opening up, whether it's the risk of opening too early and opening yourself up to criticism, but I think more specifically now, you know, it's seen as a barometer on where you are vis-a-vis Trump. He's pro-open, so if you're anti-Trump, you ought to be kind of anti-open. And I think that's a real shame, that kind of, you know, cartoon polarization, but it's real, and we should be sort of grateful, really, that I think the debate in the UK is much more grounded and measured and reasonable than it is over here.
Do you think that means that what we're going to end up with is blue states closed, red states open?
Yeah, I think there's a fascinating kind of squabble going on right now about whether the states should get bailed out by federal government. And, you know, I think the sort of Trump hawks, are their view is that right now blue state governors, this is them talking, I'm just passing it on, blue state governors are free to have longer shutdown policies than would otherwise be the case, because yes, a shutdown hurts a state's revenues as well, because tax revenues fall and so on. But California, for example, is insulated against that shortfall in tax revenue because federal government is going to bail them out. So I think one of the things that's going on in Washington right now is that the Republicans and the people around Trump are trying to end those, change the way state funding works to ratchet up the pressure on blue states to open up more quickly. But yeah, it's intensely political over here in a way that, you know, it's just not in the UK.
David, can I ask, speaking of this, you were born in Sao Paulo, you hailed from Brazil. There we have a different political situation. It makes Trump look positively cautious about this disease. Yes. And yet it looks like the share price of your airline in Brazil has plummeted to roughly the same amount as American or European airlines. What's your view of that kind of level of denial?
Well, I think Bolsonaro, who's the president, I think he's taken more of a Sweden approach. You know, he's basically saying, and I really enjoyed watching your discussion with the Swedish epidemiologist. And, you know, and I've read a lot about Sweden because obviously I think we're all just going to have to go to Sweden at some point in time. I mean, it's nice to shut down for certain reasons, but eventually, you know, I read New York Times had a report from the World Health Organization, but another UN organization that said there would be 250 million people starving who will starve this year because of this virus, which is, you know, much more catastrophic than. So eventually we have to find a coexistence strategy. We're not going to you can't eliminate it, you know, and we can't suppress it because it's so contagious. And so, you know, what basically I think Bolsonaro is trying to say is, you know, why don't we just do a Sweden? And when I read about Sweden, basically what they said is, yeah, our death rates are high, they spike, but the one lament they had is they didn't protect the nursing homes. You know, they didn't say exactly, but there's a very high percentage of the 1,500 people or now the 2,000 people in Sweden that have died that were in nursing homes. So had they protected those people, you know, if their number was 800 or 1,000 right now, it'd be a totally different conversation, you know, back to my numerator discussion. So Bolsonaro's saying, look, I don't want people starving. You know, people live, you know, it's like in India, you go out and earn your bread for the day and you eat it. If you can't earn your bread, you starve. And so it's a different thing. And so the governors are obviously opposed to him. But look, we're going to have to open up the economy and people are going to have to go back to work and they have to feed their families. And so, you know, what we need to know is really how deadly this thing is. And we need to protect those that are most at risk. And that's kind of where we're all going to end up, because they're not going to be a thing that may never come out.
The what's interesting, though, just to stick on this Brazilian example, is that there you have a government response that is, I think most people would think, much too relaxed about this virus. Even people who favor easing restrictions on the lockdown in the UK or Europe or the US would say that. And yet the damage to the economy seems about the same. You know, and even Sweden, you know, they've had, you know, there's a difference with the neighboring economies, but it's still been absolutely devastated.
Yes.
So I wonder whether this whole argument that governments are trashing the economy by installing lockdowns maybe is wrongheaded, because the economy is being hit anyway because investors are panicking and it's a global phenomenon.
The number I'd seen very on Sweden, you're much closer to Sweden than I am, but was that consumer spending had dropped by about 30% in Sweden compared to 70-80% in Norway, Denmark. So, yeah, obviously a drop, and people are rightly and understandably worried about COVID-19. But, you know, there is a big difference between being allowed to still go to work with, you know, social distancing rules and so on to not. So, you know,
consumer spending, I think the share indexes are down in a much more comparable level in Sweden. I guess that's sort of, as we try and draw this to some kind of conclusion, you know, is it within the gift or power of governments to, you know, mitigate the economic damage, or indeed to sort of end this lockdown period if consumers are going to make their own decisions about whether to go to restaurants and go on your airplanes, David? You know, whether they're told they're allowed to or not. Rohan, what's your thought? And then we'll see what they
do. It's completely right. Like, you know, government isn't all powerful. You know, they have been able to enact a shutdown. But clearly the worries people have in this current moment come from a whole variety of sources, from the media, from their own understanding, their own instincts, as well as from government messaging. But, you know, I think, you know, government, you know, in Sweden, for example, or even based on the emerging data, you know, a message which is, look, COVID-19 is still out there. In the vast majority of cases, if you get it, you're going to have mild symptoms. For those who are vulnerable, for those who are at risk, we're taking these extra precautions for nursing homes, hospitals, elderly people, and so on. But the rest of you can, within these, you know, appropriate parameters, go about your business. You know, I think a message like that over time, you know, really will, you know, bed in. You're absolutely right. I mean, I think the day that the shutdown ends, people aren't going to be rushing out into the streets again. People are going to be quite, understandably, sort of timid about heading out again. But government has a part to play, I think, in as the data emerges about the true lethality of the virus and what it, you know, what it does to, you know, the vast majority of people who contract it. You know, I think government has a real role to play there in helping calm people's fears appropriately while protecting the most vulnerable.
David, let's give you the last word here. So we're looking at airlines in Europe, in South America, in America, if we keep an eye on JetBlue as well. You know, what's your prediction? Do you think these kinds of companies, yours and other similar airlines, are they going to survive this? Do you think within a 1 year we'll see rebounding success stories within airlines? Or do you think this is now a multiple year devastation and we're going to see a whole lot of them go bust entirely?
Well, I think it depends on really, what, like Rohan said, depends what the data is actually going to tell us. And, you know, the data is coming out. And if the data comes out, you know, Dr. Ioannidis from Stanford wrote a report that said, if you're under 65 and healthy, your chances of dying, driving to work are greater than dying of coronavirus. So if people actually start to believe that, you know, if that's the data and that's what the data says, then, you know, that's obviously an important fact on getting airlines back going again. Delta, you know, is burning $50 million a day. They have $15 billion in cash and they're burning $50 billion a day. Now, they can stop by burning $50 billion a day if they lay off. If they become half the size or a quarter the size that they were, then they're not going to burn $50 billion a day anymore. So, you know, I think the length of this and how long it goes on and how people can feel comfortable to say, I'm under 65, I'm healthy, you know, I want to be able to live my life. I want to be able to take a vacation or do something. You know, I think it will depend on if Delta is 75% the size they are, 50% the size they are, or 25% the size they are. So I think a lot will depend on the data and how comfortable people get with that fact. And, you know, thank goodness, I mean, you know, that this isn't killing small children and it's not killing 25% of the people that come in contact with it. You know, it is killing a high percentage of people that have multiple morbidities and are a certain advanced stage. And I think, you know, the economy is basically shut down worldwide because we haven't figured out who those people are and how to adequately protect them to make sure they don't get sick. Well, if we can do that, then we'll rebound really quickly. And so I have a lot of hope that that's going to happen. And I think it will as soon as we get the data. It's coming out quickly and it's, you know, we'll get a lot of stuff. I'm so, you know, like I said, I've had some conversations inside the British government and they're doing this right now. They're actively doing surveillance testing. And I think they're way ahead of the US in that regard. And like Rohan said, the politics aren't nearly as divisive there as they are here. So I think they're going to come to those realizations quickly, and I think they're going to rebound a lot quicker. And I think having that example is going to help the rest of the world, including the United States and Brazil.
So you're a bull. You're a Corona bull at this point.
Well, no, I just go with the data. I'm a science guy now. I've become a science guy, and I talk to these people all day long. And I'm bullish because I know the science and I know the data is coming out. And I think it's very positive. I mean, we know who's died and we know what those people are most at risk. We need more of that stuff, because if you're working in a position where you're getting viral load, where you're getting tons of it, like a doctor or something, then that's obviously very dangerous, regardless of what your comorbidities are or what your age are. So we need to learn that. We need to learn the others. And as long as we can adequately protect them and let everyone else know, then yeah, I'm really bullish that we're going to come back, and because thank goodness this is a virus that is really hard to trace, it's really hard to find, and you know there was a huge spread in the United States before we ever knew it. The New York Times article today, but once we figure all that out, I think people are going to become a lot more comfortable.
David Neeleman, Rohan Silva, thank you both very much.
Thanks, Freddie.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
You have been watching Lockdown TV. That was a totally different view to what we are normally used to hearing on the UK airwaves, view from each coast in America. Two people involved in companies, but who are obviously taking a lot of interest for understandable reasons in the facts as they emerge. And they sound, I would say, bullish about what the prospects are in the coming months. And it looks like, if they're right, maybe things will easen up earlier rather than later. We shall see. We'll be back tomorrow with another interview at 4 p.m. Thanks for tuning in.